participating at today's meeting, as Rosa is not here, she's in Washington, D.C., and she asked me to preside. She will be here on the phone if she has any comments to help us along. I want to remind each and every one of us of something which I think we all know, but I think we need to put into the front of our minds today, especially with the topics we are going to be dealing with. We are not able to change the past. Although we'd like to look backwards sometimes and say, this is what should have been, this is how things should have been done, we cannot change the past, but we can, and we must, influence the present and the future. So I hope that's something that we can keep in mind. And therefore, today during this meeting, which I'm sure many of us have questions, just please remember that we are not here to accuse, we're not here to attack, we're here to continue to dialogue with our invited guests, and we need to thank them for coming, and we have prepared questions for each and every one of them. We would like, all of our co-chairs would like for them to be able to finish their presentations, and then we will go into the questions and answers so we're not interrupting in the middle so we can get all the information. To all of our guests, we want to thank you very much for coming. But we want to also remind you that this is not a political forum. This is not a place for cultural attacks. This is a place for dialogue. This is an open public meeting. But this is a public meeting which is open to the public, but it is a task force meeting. Therefore, there will be no questions from the from our guests. Should you have a question, should you have a comment, we definitely want to hear them. Please go to the website One Fort Worth, and you can put them there or get in contact with any of us. We'll all be happy to speak and take those comments and bring them forward as well. Now, there's a comment made by a former prime minister who once said, promoting tolerance and human dignity is one of man's unfinished challenges. So I hope today that we are able to rise to this challenge, to be able to bring about tolerance and human dignity, not only to those who we are seeking to bring them to, but also to everyone here, both of our guests and our fellow task force members, as well as the staff. So I thank you very much. We look forward to this meeting. I now open it up to my co-chairs.
Welcome. Just thanks for everybody, Megan Tagg, for coming tonight, this evening. Hopefully we'll get some good work done. Thank you.
So if that's it, we will go to item three on the agenda, approval of the minutes from the March 8th town hall and the March 19th regular monthly meeting. Does anyone have any comments about those minutes? If not, I'll entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Abstain? Motion passed. Sheriff Wayburn, we would like to thank you very much for coming this evening and coming to let us know what is going on in the Sheriff's Department. We truly appreciate it. And on behalf of all of us, thank you for being here. There are a number of questions which we provided, which Fernando provided the sheriff in his office, which were, and I once again I ask out of respect that we let Sheriff Wayburn give his presentation, and then I'm sure he will be happy to entertain questions in an orderly manner. We asked the sheriff to provide general description of his office, the demographics and the profile of the staff, the demographics and profile of those who are incarcerated, any programs that you have instituted. Remember, only 4 or 5 hours you have for this. Any programs that you initiated for racial and cultural equity, and then to comment on SB4 and the agreement with ICE, the 287G. And once again, thank you, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you for having me. As we get to, I'll finish up with the Constitution recital, the
independence, Austin, but I'll try to cover all this in brevity and maybe, you know, I understand there may be questions, is that correct?
Yes.
Well, thank you for having me here. First of all, we have an extremely diverse staff of near 1,600 personnel, and it is made up of all the community, as it were, and very much equal portions, and a lot of females representatives there, and we've set a path for success for them, and I'm proud to say that just in the last 3 months, we've promoted the first 3 female African-Americans in the history of Tarrant County Sheriff's Office. And so we have those things on staff where they're making strides to become great leaders in our department, and they certainly have that skill and ability. The group in jail, we're near 4,000 prisoners at this point, is what where we're at as far as the number of people in jail. And, you know, I look over there, and why I cannot tell you with any certainty how many African-Americans that we have, or Hispanics, or others, or anything like that, is we have very antiquated technology. But what I can tell you in some of those things is some things that they have in common, some common variables that I see among our prisoners, is about 80% of them don't have high school educations. And about 80% of them don't have a father in their life. Those are the top 2 high variables. And one of the things that we started when we got here is the old GED program had gone away from the jail for several years, and we brought that back in. In fact, we just had some of our first graduates of that program. We celebrate that with them. And we have aggressively, in regards to our prisoner population, has taken on reentry. They have different reentry programs, and we have celebrated several partnerships with a number of groups as far as reentry. We've hired 2 reentry specialists to put them in the game. We've also just tried and set the table of those folks coming back into society to try to make them as healthy and as contributable to our society as possible. And we're aggressively pursuing other programs. We have partnered with several groups, but you know, we look at that and we're trying to get them an education, we're trying to get them out and get them over to First Stop, which that program alone gives them shelter, gives them food, gives them an opportunity to train and get a skill and get them plugged into the employment world. And those people are key in some of the things that we have done there. We've brought in Alcoholics Anonymous, we've brought in NA. We have brought in other people like that in different ministries and 501c groups to give these people an opportunity to stabilize their life. And you know, we feel like our job is to set that table to make that happen inside the corridors of the jail. Because I have, you know, when we talk to police officers, and I've been a cop a long time, is I try to describe to them that I believe 98% of the people in the world is good, hardworking folks. There's about 2% we need to keep our eye on. And about half of one of those percentage points truly probably needs to be locked up for the rest of their natural lives so your family and my family is safe from that. And about half a percent really needs to get out of politics. And then there's that 1% that's going to come in and out of our jails on a steady basis. And if we can set the table for their success, and you know, it's that old phrase that you can leave the horse to water, often you cannot make it great. But without the programs, we have a 58% recidivism rate inside the jail. With people who engage and complete the programs of reentry, like the First Stop, that drops to about 6%. So it's an incredible success. But at the end of the day, the folks inside has got to have the want to. Again, the things that I stress to people as the big variables to me is this isn't rocket scientist, is that 80% of those people don't have a high school education, nor do they have a father in their life. So often I think, when I think across things, what problems do we have in our society, I often think we have a lot, but the majority of it comes because we haven't followed those problems. As we do that, we have, like I said, we've engaged all those groups, and we're trying to reduce our recidivism rate, give those people the opportunity. And we try to train our staff that their hands-on impacts them. What do we want that to look at like when they're back being our neighbor? Because most of them will be our neighbor. And also in that you need to know that out of that 4,000 people, 25% are regularly under the care of MHMR. And they issues, that's the ones that we know about. That's the ones that we know are in care. There's probably another 15% or so that need it and refuse it, or we don't detect it, one way or the other. That's a little bit about our jail and our staff. Is SB4, you know, when SB4 came about and all the writings of it, quite frankly, there was just a few changes. One is that we want to make sure that racial profiling never happens. That's unacceptable. It's an unacceptable practice. The second thing is that SB4, what it did to us was is that it made us more educated about some of our population, but one of the things that it did say is that if you're interviewing somebody because you're taking a report from them, or that they're a victim of a crime, then you cannot ask them their immigration status. Second thing was, it's a simple, by an administrator could have a policy that says, officer, you cannot ask about immigration issues when you make that traffic stop. And the fail that does not clarify there is no peace officers out there on the street and in our neighborhoods. They may be asking immigration questions indirectly, but they are conducting an investigation. There is nobody, and I think I can speak for the whole of Tarrant County, because I think you can go each department and you're going to find the same thing. There's nobody acting as an ICE agent out on the street. That's not what we're there to do. Now, often what happens is a police officer makes a stop on somebody, and suddenly they don't have any ID on them. And so they begin to ask them questions about who they are. In the plain spoken things, they begin to ask where they're from. And it comes out that they're here, and they don't have a passport, or they don't have a green card, or they don't have a visa. What have they done? They've asked immigration questions, but what are they doing? They're conducting an investigation to try to find out who they're talking to. They're not performing ICE operations. They're performing police investigation services out there on the street to figure out who they're talking to. Inside the jail, at Tarrant County, we do have the 287G program. What that means is that we have trained a group of our people and empowered them to act as ICE agents inside the jail. Where are they at? They're in the booking process. Who are they booking in? Is they're booking in Class B misdemeanors or higher, and they are checking immigration statuses of those people. And if they have documentation that they belong in the country, there is a ICE detainer on them. That ICE detainer goes up to a higher level in the ICE world, and they get an administrative warrant. And so those things go on. And so they get this warrant on them, and they stay there. Now let me give you a snapshot of who has detainers on them in Tarrant County Jail. Is we have 9 murder suspects, 1 for capital murder. We have about 71 major drug dealers that have detainers on them. We have 68 that have been arrested and charged with aggravated sexual assault on a child. We have 13 for aggravated assault on a child. And we have several that have been arrested for burglary, robbery, and the STWI. And that's the snapshot of people that you will see with detainers on them. These are not people that aren't getting into trouble. That's the only way that you can get the attention of our ICE officers is be arrested for a Class B or higher to come into our jail. So these operations only take place inside the brick and mortar. But I think I've covered everything on the ABCs on that.
Well, thank you very much. We appreciate your going through the questions. I'll now open it. If someone here has a question, I'll be happy to entertain for the sheriff.
I have one. Sheriff, did you sign a contract with Tarrant County with ICE?
Yes, sir.
And what does that contract say?
It says that they will train our people and empower and support our people, basically.
Okay. And why do you feel the need to do that?
Well, when I came into office, we had ICE officers in the jail Monday through Friday from 8 to 5. And what we saw is a lot of the people I just described were slipping through the cracks and not being detained. And so we trained people to be there 24/7 so we have a level playing field and enforce the law equally across the board.
And you were very clear about the number of people charged with murder and things like that. But you said you did not know the ethnicity breakdown of prisoners in the jail?
I didn't have that report today. I just said that's not a normal report that I see, other than what we get into.
But every prisoner is identified by race and ethnicity, right?
Well, actually, sir, in our antiquated system, we're trying to get a new system that helps us with that. They're generally identified either black or white. Now, we have origin of birth, so if they're from some other place, we will know that, but we have to manually go look for those things.
Can I ask one more question? I'll shut up.
Yes, sir.
You made changes recently in terms of visiting hours for prisoners.
I did.
And the department has gone into contracts with how you deliver money to prisoners. What I want to know is, what is that contract, and does it cost families more to give money to people who are in prison?
Well, what we had was is that, make sure I got, what was the first part of that? Sorry.
Well, the first part was whether or not that you made changes in visitation.
I did make changes in visitation.
And why was that?
Well, the reason that we did that was when we had the folks coming to the jail, we had a dog coming in all times of the day, is that the defense bar was competing with people seeing their families. And a lot of times they would see their families, and what we had was the defense attorneys having to wait in line for a long, long time. And so we looked around the state at what other people were doing, and we followed some of those practices and said, we've got to take time if we're going to move dockets, because one of the issues in Tarrant County is people wait a long time to in Tarrant County. We hold people the longest for trial, if that makes sense, that our docket is not moving as fast as the other urban counties. And part of those issues is getting to see your client. So what we were trying to do is free up a method, a fair method, where attorneys could get in and see their people. That was the first part. The second part is that we have a new commissary program, and we've tried to come into modern eras, and where we had people, if you wanted to put money on somebody's books, which is what it was, is that we were the only jail in Texas and back in the country that was doing this, is you had to physically show up at the jail, walk in, and hand money to somebody and have it put on their books, if you will, and then that took a couple of days to translate to where they could spend money in the commissary. So all we did was modernize that, or now is that you can still show up and hand us a money order? Yeah, money order, thank you. A money order. Or you can go over to a machine and feed the money into the machine, and just like an ATM, it has a fee. Or you can do it online from sitting at home. So you don't have to come downtown even to do that. So what we were trying to do is modernize things, and obviously that did cost some money, but also if you want to mail in a money order or bring down a money order, we'll happily accept that also.
You have people there who will accept a money order?
Yes, sir.
That's not my understanding, that you have to go to a machine.
Well, no, we will still accept money orders. And sometimes after hours, it gets a little bit more difficult, but we have people assigned what we call money transactions 24/7.
Yes?
How many officers have been trained as ICE agents as a percentage of the total? And how often are they trained, and who's paying for that training?
ICE is paying for the training, and we have a dozen officers.
What percentage of does that represent?
What percentage of the force? overall in detention, there's right at about 950 people assigned to detention. So my math skills are not with me tonight, but it's going to be less than 1%.
And who's paying for, I guess, when someone is being detained, who is bearing the cost of that, I guess, detainment?
Well, when they're detained, here's what happens is that they are already there on a state charge. So they have to dispose of the state charge at that point. Once they clear state charges for whatever reason, or maybe they make bond or something, then we immediately notify ICE, and they come and pick them up, they come into 13 hours. And during that time, if they need to be fed, we feed them.
Another question. What kind of public input was, I guess, collected before signing this agreement? And I guess, what was what was the driving force behind signing the agreement? I've heard from, or I've read about other counties that have discontinued their agreements.
They have what?
Like just discontinued the agreement. So,
I still don't understand, I'm sorry.
That have, I guess they have signed an agreement in the past and then no longer are just, involved in that agreement. But so what kind of community input was collected and then what was the driving force?
Well, I'll tell you, the driving force was...
Sheriff, may I interrupt you for a second? There's someone here who's complaining they were having a hard time hearing. If you could just speak up a little, please.
Oh, I'm sorry about that.
Well, actually, I was wondering if the mics could be turned up a little bit.
Could it be? Don't know.
Sure.
Sir?
Oh,
yeah. Okay, now we get into the technology. Test?
Yes.
You better?
Yes.
Thank you. I'm sorry about that.
You can start over again.
Well, I'm hoping I can remember your questions. Is the public input, I felt, was very strong because I ran on that in the campaign and the good citizens elected me. So that was, from my perspective, an endorsement of what I had in mind, if that answers your question on that. And, you know, we often hear, says, why are you doing this for ICE? Well, the sheriff's office, just like many other municipal offices and stuff like that, we have people in the DEA task force. We have people in the FBI task force. We have people in the Joint Terrorism Task Force. We have people in the Narcotics Task Force. We do joint things with the majority of federal law enforcement agencies for civil service to IRS and everything in between. So we felt, one, that it's there. Secondly, is that as why I agree with most people that we need a strong, comprehensive immigration program policy, and that we haven't got it. And by the way, I didn't run for U.S. Congress, I just ran for sheriff. I'm going to be a part of that mess. But I think that those things need to be done. But in the interim, the law is law, and I think we're responsible for participating in enforcing it.
Any other? Yes.
Yeah, thank you for your service to our county. Appreciate it.
Honored, sir.
I know some interesting information to get. I like to look at macro issues, and so my question is a little different. You talked about bringing that there are organizations that are bringing solutions to exiting prisoners that are being primarily ministries and 501c3 groups.
Yes.
That's what I do. and we love doing that kind of stuff because we really love our community and we love these people. One question, I have a couple questions for you, but one is, I doubt you can answer because I doubt you take these statistics either, but how many of the people who come into your prisons are part of a local church in their community?
That doesn't happen, but I don't know what that statistic shows. I know that we have ministers that are on our books so that they can come and see people, and or we have ministers that show up sometimes that need to get on our books, but I have no idea. But that would be an interesting question.
And you know, another one is if we're, this group is about proactivity. We're about the future and dealing with the future. One of the things that you said is you gave us this 90% figure twice. So it's a big deal to you, and I heard it loud and clear. Education, lack of high school education, as well as fatherhood being something that 90% of your prisoners have in common.
That there's the common variable.
And so what do you believe this community can do to help with that education and to help with the fatherhood problem? Because we want to keep people of every culture and every race out of there as best as we can.
Okay. I'll give you the Bill Wayman version of that, of what I think that we need to do, because I do think we have a fatherless problem that allows people not to get education. We in Tarrant County, in the greater Tarrant County area today, this morning on our feet hit the ground, we have 400 children in the foster care program whose parents' rights have been terminated and are eligible for adoption. Nobody's taken. We also know that if those children stay in perpetual foster care, we let the government do this, that 70% of them will end up in my custody or MHMR. That's the common stats that I'm hearing. So, as a group, but as a community, this is Bill Wayburn, is I would like for the governments to work very hard at getting out of the church's way and that the church take that on. And what I would like to see as a community is us stand up and say that we're going to stop this and that we are going to reach out to people and encourage people to rescue these children if we want to change this. And if we go out there and we change this and we adopt those children and they get homes forever, that percentage of 70% goes down below 10.
Wow.
So it's an incredible thing that we can do, but we've got to focus on the root cause. And the root cause, I believe, is fatherless. That if we charge out there and we say, church, go get it, and we're going to support you, and we're going to help you, and we're going to get out of it, then maybe groups like this that we can talk about how we resolve things in Tarrant County. But those children are going to end up with me if we don't do this. So I think part of the issue is that we've got to get engaged in the community and that.
I have a couple of things. Sheriff, you said fathers, you know there are a lot that for adoption these children. Said they're fatherhood. A lot of children should out there need to be adopted. You know that there are lesbian and gay couples that are being denied the right to adopt children. So it's not fatherhood, it's parents. Question for you. Some of the citizens I've talked to have said that the dress code on visitation in the jail has been more scrutinized. And you know, a lot of people come from a long way to visit some of these people that are incarcerated. Have you all considered, and I have one more question after that, have you all considered, since you're tied with the county, JPS bring over some smocks. If they're inappropriately dressed, you have them put on a smock and then they can go visit. I don't care if you rent it, you can pay $1 and rent this smock. Have you just considered something like that?
Hadn't considered it, but it's a great idea, and I'm not opposed to it. But we do want people to dress respectfully.
Absolutely. One other question, you said we need comprehensive immigration reform.
Yes, sir.
What is that to you?
Well, I didn't run for Congress. I'm going to repeat that. So I don't have all those solutions of what I see that's doing. But I do know this in a very practical sense. And I don't know what these numbers are. People say that there's 12 million illegally here, right? Or 13 million. I've heard both of those numbers. But I've also talked to immigration attorneys who said their docket in immigration reports out to 2022. We can't deport 12 million people. We can't do that. But I think that, if we were in charge for a day, is that if we could negotiate through and say we do need to secure our border. Because through that border, just side note, is that 15 years ago, if you were buying methamphetamine on our streets, you'd pay $100 a gram. Well, all the methamphetamine is coming from Mexico, and it's $20 a gram. So we have a porous border. So we need to secure a border, not only for a lot of things, but just for the narco trade and for our own security. So if we secure the border, and then if we did something here, what are we going to do with all those people? And my thing was, when I talked to an actress the other day, I said, get 1 million of them and show up at the courthouse, and I'll bet you somebody would say, we got to do something. Because we couldn't do anything with them. But if we figured out a way to compromise it to where we gave them some type of, I don't know the name of it, you know, a work visa or whatever it is, that we can get them out of the shadows and say, here you go, now go work on your citizenship. That unless you've committed some kind of crime, because I don't think we need any more criminals in our group. I think they do need to leave. But if we are able to do something in that realm of common sense and decency, we might be able to resolve it. But I think we've got to secure the border first.
There are 11 million people, but you can't incarcerate 11 million people.
Absolutely not.
I'm going to ask you one other question. The people that have been detained by ICE in the Tarrant County Jail, do you know what their country of origin is?
I do not know all of them. I know they're from, we have them from all over the world.
And let me ask you this, one last question. The majority of people who are in this country, undocumented, do you know how they got here?
I don't. I think that the stats show that the south border was one of it, but I know our airports are equally
Yeah, the stats are wrong, whatever, if you're reading that. They're not from the border. They came by boat, and they came by plane, and their student visas overstayed.
Well, there is some of that. I agree.
Corey, that's saying, thank you very much. You have another one?
Yeah, if I do, don't cut me off.
No, I'm not going to cut you off, because I wanted to go over here. You said you had one more question.
Go ahead, measure yourself.
You have another question?
No.
Okay.
We're good?
Yeah, we're good. Thank you,
thank
Sheriff.
You.
Sheriff, so if I'm hearing you, we're tasked to make recommendations. So I think I just heard you say that you'd be in favor of something like the Bracero program that was in place many, many years ago, where people would get a work permit to come and work and get a visa that would let them work here and then eventually be working toward citizenship. Is that what I heard you say?
You heard something very similar to that. I'm not familiar with the program that you mentioned, but we've got to do something to bring them out of the shadows.
Now, George W. Bush was in favor of
It's not an amnesty still. I still think they ought to get the line, if you will, to get that citizenship where that line is. Does that make sense?
All right, then the next thing I think I heard you say was that we need faith-based programs where mosques and synagogues and temples and churches stepped up to adopt children. What I heard you say?
Absolutely, you did.
Well, you kept using the word church, so I wanted to make sure you're not just talking about a Christian program. You're talking about all religions.
I am talking about all religions. I come from a Christian faith, and where I feel like I can speak into that group a little bit better than the rest of that group, because I don't know what hoops and jumps they need to go through. But I do know my own faith, and I'm personally calling out my own church, and I need everybody else to call out theirs, their faiths.
Do you see any issues there with separation of church and state?
No, I don't. I see some things that if the government got out of the way and the faith-based groups and the 501c's were able to do something like that things would be better.
Now, the other issue you brought up was you kept talking about your outdated technology. Can you be more specific about what you would need to, say, be able to track the incoming prisoners by national origin, race, all of those things that we've asked about that you haven't been able to answer?
And we have all of those informations, except the race is a little bit, the ethnicity is there, and countries of origin are there, but it's all paper. It's a paper-based group, because we have never had a Tarrant County jail management system that is electronic, where we can track you. And I mean, it is 2 years. We're working on it. But in 2 years, we hope to have bracelets for somebody who have all that information in a bracelet when they come into the jail until the time that they leave the jail. And we'll be able to track them all through the jail. We'd be able to spit out a report and say, this is how many people we got in jail. This is where they're from.
Do you have budget numbers on that?
Yes, ma'am. It is that we've just started the program in January, and we're doing it through what is called the CUC. And
what is the CUC? I'm sorry.
Council of Urban Counties. And it's probably going to be about a $12 million program. And it's taken 2 years to develop, is what they're telling me.
So is this going to be, I know you've asked around the nation for programs on commissary things and those kind of things. Is this going to be a state-of-the-art jail management data program that would be comparable with things across the nation?
Please keep in mind, I am not a tech person, but yes, that's the plan. It is going to be 2018 or 2019 technology that we'll be able to do.
Something else, but I'm blanking on it right now. Oh, you talked about 25% were under MHMR care.
Yes, ma'am.
What diagnostician is there at the jail when people are brought in that could spot the need for that care?
We have several folks from MHMR in the jail in the booking process that review and ask questions and do what you just said. They look at them, they talk to them. And if they get a hint that there's something there, then we have psychiatrists and psychologists.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lily had a question?
Is it okay that I came out here because I couldn't hear? Is that working?
That's fine.
I'd kind of like to know, what have your disappointments been since you've become up here? Where has the community missed an opportunity? And as it relates to this task force and what you know about this community now, what would you recommend to us? So two questions.
Well, I think that one is getting together and having the discussion is the first part of the solution. But two is that fear gets out ahead of the truth. I've seen that in a few issues. And trying to catch up with it's been very, very difficult. And that has been frustrating to figure out, hey, we're not doing some of these things that we're doing. Or not going out to construction sites or going out to this site or this business to round up illegal aliens. And we're not doing that. So that was put out for some of the 287 stuff. But I will tell you, things, and I appreciate that, the real frustration has been the amount of bureaucracy in Tarrant County just to get something done. I found out very quickly that I had the largest budget in Tarrant County and I couldn't buy chocolate chip cookies for promotion ceremony, but that's a whole other story. But is that I think the frustration up there is trying to communicate and get that communication out before. And I, you know, that's me. It's on me that we haven't done that as well as we should have. And
they're just trying to get it out. Okay, thank you. The whole thing about changes within the system that you're responsible for and have authority over is the heart for people who are locked up and they have families with care. I think maybe just better communication when changes are made would help a lot.
Yes,
okay.
And I think that we have done a good job of communicating
that. Thank you. Any other questions?
I'm not sure if you addressed this before I stepped into the meeting, but can you talk to us about the cost structure, or whether it's a cost or a revenue opportunity for using the 2017 program?
Revenue? I know
through
no
ICE or anything? Is there any pass-through money or anything?
No,
that's going
not
on
that.
From that standpoint?
There's no revenue issues that I know.
I'm just trying to understand in some way some of the additional benefit for the county to participate.
The participation was from a community standpoint, from a county standpoint, is that if you had somebody in jail that was in there for murder and he was illegally in the country, is that there would be an extra layer of accountability for that person to get out of the community. And what we've found across the nation, where ICE, where 287G program was, is we saw crime rates drop because they effectively did that. And were able to take people that, such as that, and was able to report them in front of more guidance.
And you're only allowed
to have statistics? I'm sorry, I have a follow-up.
Well, 1 second, one at a time, please.
Sorry. Do you have statistics from before the 287G program was implemented, or after, as well as what before SB4 or after that you could share with us, whether it's today or following?
We might be able to follow up some of the statistics of what was before, but we don't know what we don't know in regards to it wasn't the same.
The policing agency, you're only allowed to have 12, correct?
No, we could have more. We had a goal of covering 24/7 in booking where people would process through it.
Follow up.
Yep.
Any other questions?
I've got one. I got here a little bit late, but I want to know, you're dealing with ICE and you're working with, how many retainees do you have?
We probably have, and again, horrible stats because of technology, but we average between 250 and 300.
And are any of those children?
No.
No children?
No.
Okay.
They're all adults.
Since the number of people coming across the border illegally has dropped precipitously, have you seen any follow through in the numbers in your jail?
No, we've averaged about those numbers each month. And a lot of times, by the way, is that following up with ICE, is these people, once they go through the system and they go to ICE, a lot of times their issues, federal summons, and they go back into the community, depending on what they've done.
Yes.
I know you deal with individuals.
Yes, sir.
Could you let me know if you've got the numbers, how many individuals are you holding? Individuals, and then how many are you holding that have families that are here too?
I don't know those facts. But I do know this, is that one of the things I asked ICE earlier was what happens when the detainee is going to be deported? They've gone through the deportation process and they're about to be deported. before such a court. But they will give them an opportunity to notify their family, and they will, the whole family can be, go to the same, go back home together. If that's chosen.
Back home?
Back home.
What if their home is here?
Well, I understand that. We're talking about where their legal home is.
If they were born here, their legal home is here.
Oh, there's no question about that. It's a voluntary thing. Absolutely.
No, no, I'm just,
yeah, absolutely.
Clear.
Absolutely.
Anyone else? Sheriff, thank you very much for coming this evening. I really appreciate it.
Good job.
We now have a briefing on by Russell Wilson II, a special prosecutor for Tarrant County District's Office, Attorney's Office, about the indictment of police officer Romer. We also...
Yes, sir.
Yes. We also know that there are certain boundaries and limits of what you can and cannot say, and we appreciate whatever you information you could give us without jeopardizing in any one way or the other the case. So thank you very much.
No problem. And I think also on the agenda with me is Chief Proud.
Actually, we have the real chief.
So let me thank Chief as well. We have you here at a different part as well. But let me thank you very much as well for coming today. We want to thank you for your relationship with the committee and the community. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. So, you know, I was invited here to speak, in general, giving you a little bit of background regarding the indictments of John Romer. As you mentioned, there's a limit on what you can say as a prosecutor really regarding the case. So what I'm going to do is give you a little bit about my background and then kind of repeat to you some information that I think has been out there in the public arena. And then maybe I'll be able to answer questions that you may have just in general terms. So just a little bit about my background. I'm an attorney practices in private practice in Dallas. I think this is going into my 22nd year. I'm board certified in criminal law, formerly in the Dallas County District Attorney's Office, where I was a special fields bureau chief, and I was, in that capacity, probably the most prominent thing that I was involved in was the Conviction Integrity Unit, which dealt with exonerations of individuals who were wrongfully convicted. But also under my purview was the Public Integrity Unit. In Dallas, we had a number of issues with officer-involved shootings, excessive force cases, and things of that nature. So that's where my kind of prosecutorial background came up. In this particular case, the notes say Tarrant County District Attorney's Office, but I actually function independent of the Tarrant County District Attorney's Office. The District Attorney's Office recused themselves in this case, and the reason that they recused themselves was because they were potential witnesses in this particular case. So you may recall that generally the District Attorney's Office has jurisdiction over all crimes that occur within the county. There's really only a very limited number of circumstances where they will recuse themselves. And that's what happened in this case. After the recusal of the district attorney's office, I was appointed as a special prosecutor in the case. The special prosecutor, I think the actual title is attorney pro tem. But in general, I function as the district attorney's office, but in a much more limited scope. And in this case, it was a limited scope regarding an investigation of a police incident with Henry Newsom. At the point in time when I was appointed as a special prosecutor, Officer Romer had not been formally charged with any criminal charges. I initiated a grand jury investigation into the facts and circumstances surrounding what got me appointed as a special prosecutor. A grand jury investigation gives the authority to subpoena records, interview folks, and that's kind of what happened. in general terms. I will say, you know, that the Fort Worth Police Department was integral in the investigation going forward. When I was initially appointed on the case had come back to Tarrant County District Attorney's Office through a person in the Special Investigations Unit of the Fort Worth Police Department. And so that officer had brought the charges of the issues to the attention of the District Attorney's Office. District Attorney's Office had reviewed the matter and determined that they needed to recuse themselves. I then picked up the case. I conducted oversaw a grand jury investigation. And at the end of the investigation in the past month, Officer Romer was indicted on the charges of aggravated perjury, which is a third degree felony. Carries a range of punishment from 2 to 10 years imprisonment up to a $10,000 fine. Was indicted on the offense of official oppression, which is a Class A misdemeanor. Range of punishment is 0 to 365 days in jail, up to a $4,000 fine. He was indicted for making false statements to law enforcement personnel, specifically people in the district attorney's office. That offense is a Class B misdemeanor, a range of punishment from 0 to 180 days and up to a $2,000 fine. So after the cases were indicted, there was other news stories that came out. I've seen some of the news footage of a video of the incident, but that was not released by me. And I believe the city of Fort Worth and perhaps the police department released some other information related to it. Those cases are currently pending, and they will proceed in the same fashion that the felony cases are pending in the 297th Judicial District Court. They'll proceed in the same fashion as any other felony case. So I'm anticipating that those cases will likely go to trial. And you know, the trial will be just what you've seen in all other police officer or officer involved cases, where you know, Officer Romer will have an opportunity to present his defense, and I'll be the person representing the state, and I'll have the opportunity to present our evidence that we seek to prosecute him on, and then a jury of 12 folks will make a decision regarding that case. So that's kind of a general overview of the case involving Officer Romer. I'm sure there's, I'm anticipating there may be some general questions regarding the case that I can answer that were not included in my overview. And so I'm happy to entertain those, or I can refer to the chief if you'd like.
Why don't we go first questions for you and then the chief. So are there any questions?
I have a question.
Okay, we'll start. Yes, Nate.
Can you help me understand the timeline here? The incident happened in November of 2016?
Yes, ma'am.
Correct? The case was dropped in March of 2017?
That's correct.
A special prosecutor was finally appointed in January of 2018. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And that's when Romer was suspended. Is that correct?
You know, I don't know the specific date. I don't believe he would have been suspended contemporaneous with my appointment as a special prosecutor.
Romer, since he was under investigation, was taken off the street. He was not suspended at that time, but taken off the street in limited capacity. He wasn't allowed to take part in any arrests. It's a restricted duty capacity.
So from November 2016, though, till January 2018, he was on the street functioning as a police officer.
Not until January. He was taken off the street in December of 2017.
Of 2017.
That's correct. But yes, he was performing his duties as a police officer during that intermittent time. That's correct.
And I assume that the police department had reviewed that tape of the arrest and the assault.
Pursuant to probably what you received in the timeline, we did not get that information or review.
Chief, if you may, and I apologize to interrupt, but I think what may help everyone out understand it, you can explain the 180-day process of the investigation, how that came about, and I think that may help guide a little bit of the timeline.
Okay. In this case, in any typical complaint against police case, notwithstanding any use of force or any other potential infraction, an officer has the burden of proof on the organization or the agency to complete that investigation within 180 days, unless that investigation is or turns out to be criminal in nature. So I don't want to confuse you, but I'll say if you look at 180 days is what the police department has to complete that investigation. In this instance, the use of force is brought to the attention of the supervisor. The duty of the supervisor is to then process the use of force paperwork to bring it to the attention of people higher in the chain of command and to make recommendations whether they're for disciplinary action or corrective counseling or to just identify what happened within the course and scope of whatever police action led to a potential violation of the code of conduct. In this instance, it never came to our attention within that 180 days. The police supervisor that was involved was negligent in completing that process and had subsequently received disciplinary action for not doing so. So in this instance, police officer Romer's actions, when he came to the attention of, in particular, me, he was immediately reassigned to a non-street assignment. While we still conduct our investigation, and we did conduct an investigation, that is how we found also that the supervisor was negligent. And he was not at that point, because the 180 days had passed between the time of the infraction that he would have been able to work in some kind of disciplinary action or potential disciplinary action against Romer. Since that time had passed, again, we still conducted an investigation and still saw it as being very problematic to us. That's one of the reasons when you have a police complaint that has a potential to be both criminal and administrative, the administrative case is bound by the 180 days, however, a criminal case is not. The criminal case is presented like any other criminal case would be presented through our special investigation unit. And as our attorney, our special prosecutor mentioned, it was seen fit to go before the grand jury and process that. But we were, in essence, in the chain of command, recommendations and process of paperwork and the norm. This fell outside the norm. It was not processed properly, and the supervisor was responsible as much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
What is he charged with, his actual charges?
Well, I wanted to add one other thing that I think perhaps contributed, while it wasn't a prerequisite to the timing, there was no internal affairs complaint filed regarding this incident. And so the Fort Worth Police Department's use of force review is a different process than an initiation of an internal affairs complaint. I'm not going to go, I guess, into those extensively, but I think it is a contributing factor when you ask regarding the timeline of events. There was no, and that's not, again, the place fault anywhere, there was no internal affairs complaint regarding this incident. I think, use of force review is one way that matters come to the attention of the Fort Worth Police Department. Another way that they come to the attention of the Fort Worth Police Department is through internal affairs complaints. And I think the final way is probably just general citizen complaints.
Who initiates an internal affairs complaint?
An internal affairs complaint can be initiated by a police officer, by a citizen. So in this instance, administratively, I have the power to say, we still have a complaint here, we need to investigate it. And in the spirit of transparency, that's what we do. No matter whether it's within the 180-day window or not, I still have the duty to ensure that all complaints are processed properly. And whether or not, in this instance, once the complaint falls outside that 180 days,
What is he charged with, Officer Romer?
He is charged with aggravated perjury, which is a third degree felony. He's charged with official oppression, which is a class A misdemeanor. And he's charged with making a false statement to law enforcement personnel, which is a class B misdemeanor.
Chief, you've made some changes to ensure that something like this happens again, that it will not pass that 180 days. Could you tell us about what you
Sure. Time. I'll tell you, we made a tremendous amount of changes. Initially, a police supervisor, you know, has to be notified when there's use of force. In this case, again, the police supervisor was notified, but it did not do the necessary follow-up that it needed to bring to the attention of the chain of command. But what we've done is set a 3-day time limit that a police supervisor would push that information up and it would go to internal affairs unit for all use of force cases that did not exist in the past. That was left at the level of whatever place in the organization that person worked. So, and what broke in the system, in my opinion, is that there wasn't a check and balance in place at that time to ensure that within a finite period of time that paperwork was done, that it was put into the system, and we broke the level of you know, even executive staff members knowing that the complaint existed. What's also changed is that we formed with very finite periods of time with each rank, I should say with each command level within the organization, that a complaint was sit. We want to ensure that we don't run up against a 180-day timeline. When I first became chief here in the city of Fort Worth, I reduced that timeline to 100 days. Clearly, some things, expand well beyond the 100-day mark. When there's a criminal investigation, and I don't want to get off into the weeds too much, we can apply to the Attorney General's office to place that 100-day timeline in advance until the criminal trial is set, or until the criminal trial is disposed of, I should say. And in this instance, I'll bring you back to the case we're talking about. Since there are criminal allegations, there are another set of complaints administratively that we look at that, depending upon the findings within the criminal hearing, we can say we can now apply other discipline that there was a new 180-day clock that starts ticking at that point. So we've opened another set of internal investigations, you know, for this particular event. But there have been, you know, several things. I mean, I can go over, I brought a flow chart to describe some of the things that we're doing, and I can make sure each member the panel get it. But we've looked at timelines and said that what's reasonable, you know, for a normal use of force complaint that doesn't involve any type of criminal activity. And that's the key caveat here, criminal activity. If there is no criminal activity alleged in the use of force or no criminal activity that we've seen, and we feel between 35 and 40 days we can get that that process through every chain. Every portion of the chain of command. Those levels within the chain of command require write-ups, and those write-ups are about what each person in the chain saw and their recommendations on what they saw as far as discipline or education-based discipline or anything that happens as a result of the use of force or complaint period. So it doesn't matter whether it's a use of force complaint or a complaint about rudeness or anything else. Every complaint goes to the chain of command, gets recommendations, and those recommendations, we tighten the timelines on to ensure we, again, don't run up against 180 days. And certainly press members of the internal affairs staff and press members of the patrol staff that obviously patrols the largest portion of the department, so that's where we get the greatest number of complaints that we deal with. But I felt that, you know, we really needed to take a good, hard look at how we were processing things and we could do it in a more efficient manner. And based upon just my work with the internal affairs investigators, I think we've done a heck of a job reducing that timeline and ensuring that not only will we not necessarily go beyond 180 days with checks and balances now, but we'll get, you know, these investigations done in a more timely manner.
Okay, that was a softball. Here's the fastball.
You sure that was a softball?
if you had this been brought to your attention within those 180 days, and you can expand on this regardless of the outcome of the potential of the trial, you still have the ability to make an administrative decision regardless of the outcome of the trial, guilty or not guilty. He still will face you.
That's correct.
180 days have gone by, and you, everything you know now, would you have terminated him then?
I can't say, because I have to take into account, again, what we've seen is what we've seen, and we know what the video looks like. But I also haven't heard or haven't had the opportunity to hear the officer testify. I haven't had the opportunity to hear the young person that was on the video as well, that was struck. There's testimony to be heard, and some of that information is going to be very germane to what happens with this investigation. So I'd like to say we give everything a due process. In this case, the due process flew in our face because we had a kink in the due process system that should have never happened. We can't apologize enough for due process not working in the manner in which it was supposed to, but what you can expect out of me and what you can expect out of this department are tighter timelines, making sure that we don't run past that 180 days and that we get the opportunity to take a good hard look at the actions and activities of police officers before perhaps we lose our opportunity to take corrective action.
Thank you.
Well, Chief, I appreciate you said it a couple of times, you've taken a good hard look. You operate now in the Civil Service Commission, is that true?
We do.
Do you think it's outlived itself? It was established in Fort Worth in 1940. And so the things that we're talking about today and the difficulties you're having is because of those guidelines. Other major cities have gone away from that. So I just wondering if y'all had to give that any thought at all.
We thought of it. There are things that we can do. We can sit down with our police officer association and have open and honest communications about what we're expecting to see. And in the case of the police officers from our peers, in the case of me and my executive staff, what our expectations are from the officers that we meet every day. There is a level of expectation that we have to have, and that level of expectation has been higher over the last few years. I've been here about 2.8 years, and I'll say that the level of expectation has changed greatly, and it should. This is a different time. This is a different time in the world where people have expectations that are elevated for our department. And should they be? Yes. We have to behave better. And we have to do it a lot better than we've done in the past. It goes a long way to what we've taught officers in the form of procedural justice and our implicit bias training and others that dictate that we don't handle situations poorly and try to avoid as much as we can the encounters that lead to these type of actions. And that is a part of being responsible as the chief of police, but a part of taking on that responsibility from the police officer level on up. We all have a responsibility, and we know that our actions may in a long way go to dictate how police officers are seen, not only in the city of Fort Worth, but throughout the country. And I have no doubt that some of the things that we've seen throughout the country have had a really polarizing effect upon what we see here in Fort Worth. So every officer has to do it better. And that expectation can be leveled, and I think fairly, upon our department. So yes, we're tightening up the ship. Yes, the expectation level is much higher for officers. And is that right? Yes, it is, because we have to do a better job. And we have to be transparent. We have to make sure we put our money where our mouth is and go out and assure citizens that the level of trust that we work towards is something that we're legitimately moving towards. We can talk about it, or we can demonstrate it. And I think that this department has done a great job in the last few years of dealing with terrible, terrible situations, but taking some accountability for what we've done wrong and making sure that we corrected some of these things quickly. Some things have been preempted before they ever needed to be corrected in the realm of an open meeting, right? We made corrections and changes to the way we do business that you'll probably never see unless you pick up some of our general orders and take a look at the changes that have happened since 2016 and now. But I want to reassure folks that they can have every confidence in the world that our department will take a good hard look at itself every time something happens, and people, not just the police chief, but people from the bottom up in this organization that work every day, take a really, really good critical look at what other officers are doing. And, you know, some of our officers can be the most, they can be even a harder critic than I can about some of the actions that they've seen. It's been really disappointing, but we know that we're human beings, and we're going to have instances where we screw up, right? But when we step up, and we admit that we screwed up, and we step up, and we, you know, we make the changes that are necessary, and we put ourselves in a position to be successful, I think the city and city management can have the kind of response that says, you know what, our department's on top of this. They know that they need to make changes, that they know they need to address certain issues. And I want people to say, you know, we have every confidence that they'll handle it. And that's the feeling that I've gotten so far.
Mark, Chief, you've worked a couple of different departments, ran a few departments. You ever worked with a citizens review board? So what are your thoughts on that?
I haven't worked with a citizens review board for
or the city with one.
The city of Philadelphia, where I worked for, you know, close to 18 years, had a review board, and some cases went before that board. And I can't say that in Missouri City or downtown I've had that experience, but I do know that there's a lot of research out there and a lot of different ways in which review boards have been put in place. I think that we're remiss if we don't say that, you know, we have to take a good hard look at the way we do business. I would just ask that one of the things we do as a group here is take a look at how we're handling things. And how you do that is not one-off, right? You see the really terrible things that we've seen in the media lately, but I want you to take a look at the hearings that we had, the arbitration processes that we had. Take a look at these investigations that have led to more than one day off, and engage how this department has been handling bad behavior. So if you look at one instance or two instances, you get an artificial idea of how we handle things. But if you look at arbitration cases, and you look at the level of, at least since the time I've been here to present, what kind of punishments have been, you know, handed out for things that really deserved it, and how that's been handled in the arbitration process. It's an open process. So anybody here, just like we're having a meeting here, you can participate, you can see. And I think that would lead you to believe, at least I would hope, that we are handling things right. I think if you do it in a vacuum, or if you're looking at things and you're looking at one or two instances where you've seen, you know, data, or you've seen some of the things on television, and you don't look at the overall macro of it, you don't really get a good idea of how well we're functioning as an organization. So I want you to really think about it before we move down into a direction like that. Just, you know, give ourselves an opportunity to really evaluate what we've done and how we've been doing it and what progress we've made in comparison to other times where we've had other chiefs.
Thanks.
Todd?
I'm just curious to know if you have a position or your thoughts on the Citizen Review Board in general.
I don't have a position on it at this point. This is really, I've heard nothing official about any type of movement towards getting a civilian review board, but again, I think it's a conversation to have, and I think let's not view it in a very myopic manner. Let's make sure that we get a true gauge on what this department is doing in the realm of, you know, how we handle officer discipline, how we educate and train officers and try to correct problems. And if we get a true gauge on how we're handling things, and then it's discussed, I think that's the discussion that we can have. I'm going to tell you that no matter what, I'm going to be a chief that listens and is transparent and sits down and has these conversations, tough conversations with groups like this that have the best interests of this city at heart. You have to practice what you preach, and you reference the transparency. And one of the things that we have to exercise as a community is the ability to pull some of the information, read some of the transcripts, the testimony, and negative behaviors. And then once we have that information before us, let's then talk about where we need to go and what we need to do about it.
Just a quick question, actually, to the prosecutor, Chief. Just briefly, considering the charges that you brought?
Yes, sir.
And considering what you saw on tape?
Yes, sir.
I'm wondering why this officer was not charged and indicted with assault as opposed to official oppression, which I think is the least charge you can really come up with somebody who's been abusing.
What I can tell you, sir, is that assault in Texas is also a Class A misdemeanor. Official oppression is a Class A misdemeanor. The offense of official oppression, I believe, is broader than just the offense of assault. So official oppression can occur when a person subjects a person to mistreatment in their official capacity.
I guess I should have said felony assault.
No, sir. So a felony assault in Texas usually would either be a family violence issue involving choking, type of a boyfriend, girlfriend, or the most frequent instances of that. And this would have, if it were charged as an assault, I believe be a Class A assault. The person, Mr. Newsom, who was injured, didn't suffer serious bodily injury, which is, you know, significant impairment of a bodily function or a break of the bone, which is normally what's required under an aggravated assault type charge. So there's not a felony simple assault. You know, a striking of a person, you know, in the capacity as a law enforcement officer, there are certain protections that the penal code offers to you in that capacity. And so those come up whether it's an assault case or an official oppression case. But for all intents and purposes, the actual most serious offense charge is the aggravated perjury charge, which is a felony charge. But you know, somebody else may have saw it, seen it just as an assault. Official oppression is specifically designed to recognize that a person is acting in their official capacity or under the color of law, and I think that's why that statute is on the books for Texas.
So what's, given where we are and your appointment earlier this year, what's the expected timeline for this case?
I will request that the judge give us a trial date as soon as possible, and I'm hopeful that may be late summer, early September. Again, I'm a private practicing attorney, so I do carry a regular docket as well, and I do, I have a significant practice, but I'm hopeful that September, August time frame. I don't know what the court's docket is. Generally, the folks that are incarcerated in your jails are the folks whose cases are heard first. And, you know, so sometimes bond cases take a little bit longer. I know this is a matter of public interest. I think it's important that society answer these questions, and I'll impress that on the court. At the end of the day, it's the judge's decision as to what day we go to trial. I expect he will try to accommodate Officer Cooper and ensure that his attorneys had adequate time to prepare and things of that nature. But I believe that could be done by the end of the summer.
Any other?
I have one more question. Chief, does the police department have something like a public integrity unit? If it does, I suggest after the trial is over, you might want to talk with Mr. Wilson there. He is one of the, I've known him for a few years, one of the finest legal minds in this country, and he's run one for Insight.
I appreciate that question. We actually do. Our Special Investigations Unit is, in essence, a public integrity unit. They handle those types of sensitive complaints internally that are criminal. They can handle complaints that involve people in city management or politicians, that type. had one thing I just wanted to say. One of the things that, you know, coming out of this process with this incident and other incidents that we had is, I want to invite you all, especially this group, to come and take part in a training session that we just put together for civilians. And it's, we're calling it the CRT scenario training. It's going to be civilian scenario-based use of force training. And we were just kicking it off, and we're going to have our first scenario training for civilians on 5/19 and 3/19 at 9 a.m., 9 to 1 p.m. So that's Saturday, May 19th. The schedule as it stands now will be Saturday, May 19th, Saturday, June 2nd from 9 to 1 as well, Thursday, June 21st, and we'll put this all up on our website, Facebook, and such. So Thursday, June 21st from 5:30 to 9:30 p.m. Saturday, July 14th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And Monday, August 20th from 5:30 to 9:30 p.m. And this is designed to show folks, especially our citizens that are, you know, involved in the racial culture, of course, to those that are watching online, television, again, in that spirit of openness and transparency, we want to give you an idea of what we're training our officers in. I mean, we can come up here and put on a PowerPoint presentation, but this will be a little hands-on as well. So my hope is that we can convey the level of training that we're providing our officers is something that you can look to and reference. It's a good deal to be able to have an educated group that are able to see it for themselves and to be able to just engage one another in a different means. And this isn't a design to explain away any behaviors or nothing like that. What I want you to do is you know, try to make one of these sessions and just open yourselves up to learning some of the things that officers have to do on a day-to-day basis and some of the responsibilities that we level on our officers as well from the top down. So, I will be a part of these training classes as well. So,
is this put on by the same group that did the de-escalation training that we were invited to take part in?
This would be some instructors that are a part of the de-escalation training, because use of force training is, in essence, one of the steps that we asked officers to go to with de-escalation. So there will be some of the same instructors. But this will be, you know, there'll be some scenario-based things that I think we can all, you know, get a lot out of. So I do implore you to make some time to look at that schedule, to contact us and let us know which one makes sense for you, and we'll make it happen. But I think it's overdue that we bring in our citizenry and let them see really what we're teaching and to see the things that we're not. Because, you know, there are some misnomers out there about what we permit. And I want to debunk that now and be able to bring you in to really get a hands-on, no pun intended, opportunity to experience some of the things that the average officer learned.
Would you consider putting that, broadcasting that on Facebook Live or the city's access channel as well?
Sure, that's actually a great idea. I think that'd be good. Putting it on Facebook Live so everyone can see it, that they can, and it would be something I'd be more willing to do.
Any other questions? Mr. Wilson, we want to thank you very much. Chief, we want to say we're very thankful that you were back up on your feet. I don't know if everyone knew Chief had back surgery. We're tremendously happy that you're healing and you should be back to full strength soon and continue that way. And before the next presentation, a briefing on the Chaparral Apartments, on behalf of the co-chairs, when the video, just to let you know, when the video came out, the chief, the mayor, Mr. Chapa and the four of us met to discuss about this and the transparency about what happened with the video that was caught, and then the chief and the city deciding to release the full body cam. We truly appreciate that transparency, coming to tell us what happened, showing us what happened, and showing the entire citizenry what happened. So we thank you and we applaud you. We hope you continue that to be transparent, not only here, but everywhere. So we thank you very much ahead of time for that.
Thank you all.
Okay. We are now at item number six, the briefing on the March 31st incident near the Chaparral Apartments. Jay Chapa, and I don't know if the assistant chief or the chief is doing this one.
So the chief is here on the
sure, okay.
You can give me any kind of
time. Would you like some water when you leave?
Well, really, as the mentioned, we did have the opportunity after this incident, I think the Monday after the incident occurred on a Saturday, and then went somewhat viral over the weekend on the internet. The mayor, I believe, has a monthly meeting with the chairs of the task force, and we did have an opportunity to meet with these in that meeting and discuss the issues that were out there. Part of the overall process, and I'm going to turn over to the chief to talk about where that is, but one of the things that really in the feedback from the co-chairs that helped us take a broader look at the overall occurrence. At the end of the day, we want to make sure, as the chief mentioned, that the citizenry, this task force, the elected officials have great confidence in what the police department's doing and what the city is doing.